What's up, everyone? Welcome to Bilbrons and Dragons. I'm your host, Bilbron Bafflestone. So today we're having another battle report for my Molbron Dowlock Stone build, which I've been playing on a Westmarch server called the Forged Concordance. And it is so awesome, so I highly recommend it. All of the relevant information will be in the video description below. Feel free to check it out and we can adventure together. So today's episode was called Tattoo Taboo, run by DM Landslan. And DM Landslan did a fantastic job, I have to say. This session featured what I think is my most favorite battle so far out of all the ones that I've had at the Forge Concordance. This was one where I was legitimately challenged, legitimately pressed. There was one point where I was like, oh my god, are they going to get me? And I got saved by a party member, basically. So I really look forward to describing this battle. And I really want to thank DM Landslan for providing it to me and the whole session in general. So the adventure begins, as it always does. Bilbron rolled in from Vaskala, stopped in at Haroon to check in with Novus Deshout, and then on to the TFC HQ to check the job board for a gig. And for once, it wasn't that hard. I approached, and there was already a mostly assembled team put together. It was led by Jazz Kern, who was a Verdon lore bard, who had a really energetic energy to her. She had great role play. I really enjoyed playing with her, and she was the one that saved my butt later. There was Chromia, who was a warforged artificer armorer, who was a super good chef, who tragically couldn't taste any of his creations, and had like a voice modulator that was really cool. So, great role play out of Chromia. And then Witch, who I had adventured with in the previous adventure, the Clockwork Lair. And so she's a human moon druid who's really competent, and I love her look. And, she was kind enough to invite me to the team, because Jazz Kern was specifically looking for summoners for some reason. And, that's kind of where Bilbron has his area of expertise. So Bilbron was allowed to join the team. And then we needed one more, so we added Chaz Luminaria, who was a pretty striking human divine soul sorcerer, celestial warlock. Just one level of divine soul sorcerer, so mostly a celestial warlock. And she had an imp. Oh, and I should mention that Jazz Kern was also riding a winged llama. I think it was a reskinned Pegasus. But pretty flavorful party already out of the gate. And the job was for a Joseph Herman, who lived in Lady's Rest, and his daughter had disappeared, and he wanted us to get her back. So, okay, we can all get behind that. We headed out, and it was a pretty short journey to Lady's Rest. We only took a couple of days to get there. We all got to know each other, and Bilbron told some of his inspiring stories. And right away when we arrived, we noticed a general despondency in the citizens. They were just moping around. So we asked them about it, and it seems like there were a lot of disappearances of young women all around the same age. And it coincided with the arrival of these tattooed outsiders. And so we were like, okay, got a sense of what's going on here. And as we were on our way to the client, Witch, who has this insane perception, knocked out a 29 perception roll to notice a couple of, tattooed dudes skulking in the corner. They were wearing robes, and one had plate mail and a sword, and then one seemed to be small and shifty, kind of like a goblin. And so Jazz Kern chose to approach and had a really hilarious conversation with them, but it didn't really turn up too much actionable intel, but it did give us a point of contact, and both Bilbron and Chaz sent their invisible familiars to follow them while we went to meet the client. So the rest of the team went on to the estate of Mr. Herman, because this dude turned out to be loaded and had just like a freaking mansion and all of that. And when we arrived, we knocked, there was no answer. Bilbron used Minor Illusion to shout out, hey, TFC, we're here, and no response. So we tried the door, it was unlocked, we cautiously entered and found our client, Mr. Herman, in a food coma, writhing around on the floor, surrounded by kiwis. I guess this dude ran a kiwi farm, and that was like the source of his wealth. And Witch had enough medical knowledge to know what to do, and Jazz Kern had the fortitude to stick a finger up his nose, and this revived him. And we had a brief conversation where he said, yeah, my daughter Annabelle was visiting this cemetery where her long-lost love was buried, because I guess he got killed like a year ago or whatever, and she was still in the mourning period and visiting his grave every day. And she disappeared, and he was certain that these tattooed outsiders were behind it. Didn't really have any evidence, but, you know, intuition can be a strong thing. And so we were like, all right, we're all on this, we're gonna get your daughter back. And so Bill Brown recalled Fargar, his familiar, and it was Fargar was able to lead us to an area of the forest where these two tattooed dudes had entered. So the team went in, and we decided to go in with stealth. So Bill Brown activated his Merge with Stone / Pass Without Trace ability, and we were able to get the jump on the outer forces, the, you know, like guard regiment of the tattooed cult. Because, I mean, they're a cult, right? We could pretty much figure that out at this point. And so we launched a battle that was very interesting. These tattoos gave them really cool powers, like they could inflict a piercing vulnerability on you and double up their damage, and they were teleporting around, and they could cast spells. And so I wouldn't say it was a difficult battle, because they didn't really have too many answers for Bill Bron's main tactic of keeping his distance, and, you know, the rest of the team was slaying him as well. So we knocked one out with non-lethal damage and killed the rest, and then we interrogated the prisoner. And it turns out that these tattooed guys are a cult, and they were kind of, you know, hitting up the lowly and poor of Ladies Rest and getting them to join. And then they were covering them with these tattoos, which was forcing their compliance. And we learned that there was going to be a ritual of some kind being completed tonight. And we had, from analyzing the tattoos before, realized that they were very demonic in nature. So we were like, okay, demon tattoos, a ritual, and we've got a missing girl who we could probably assume is going to be a sacrifice for this. And so we were about to move on, and we were debating on whether what to do about this prisoner, when all of a sudden her tattoos flared up and killed her. So that took some of the decision-making off of our plate, and we pushed on and came across the cemetery from which Annabelle was taken. And very unusually, there was a sword sticking out of a grave. And so Witch went up and pulled it out and actually had a conversation with it, because this sword was intelligent and apparently animated by the spirit of Annabelle's dead lover. So this is pretty funny. So Witch had been killing it on her ability checks all the way up until this point, but she had to make a persuasion check against the sword and rolled a one. So yeah, the sword was not having any of it and immediately hit her for 100 damage. I was like, what? That's literally the biggest hit I've seen so far in this game. And yeah, took her down to zero right away. And this was problematic because she had summoned a fire elemental. And when you lose concentration on fire elementals, they become uncontrolled and they're hostile to the party. And fire elementals can do a ton of damage because they just need to touch you and go through your space, and they'll do damage and set you on fire. And so that's exactly what this thing did. It dashed and it hit everybody in the party, except for Bill Brown, who was operating from 300 feet up, and set them on fire and did some damage. And Witch had, you know, just gotten taken down to start the battle, and we were like, oh my goodness, this is not off to a good start. But we were able to immediately regain control because Chaz came over and banished both the sword and the fire elemental. And so we were only left to deal with these like death knights or something. I don't know what they were, but, you know, they were like undead dudes in armor that had been summoned by the sword to support it. And so we were able to pretty much methodically take down these death knights, and then we waited for the banishment to reach the end of its duration, and at the end of it, the elemental was gone completely, and then the sword came back, and we just all, dogpiled it and managed to shatter it without too much difficulty. After that, we looked around and, we took a rest, and then we looked around and found a secret entrance to like an underground chamber or complex. And so we went in, and right away we found a little alcove where we found a book called Demon Summoning for Dummies. And so we're like, ah, gosh, I wonder what they're doing here. And then we went into another room where there were a couple of dudes sketching out a ritual circle and like doing a ritual. And one looked like kind of like a jackal werewolf dude. And one guy looked kind of like an insectoid bug man, kind of like a Thrycreen almost, but like uglier. And Chromia took point on talking to them. And these guys were super chill. they were happy to talk with Chromia because they considered him an ally, because Chaz had sent her imp familiar in with them. And even though it was invisible, they had blindsight. So they're like, oh, hey, what's up, buddy? And oh, this is your friend of yours too. Hey, friend of yours, friend of mine. And so they were just very chatty. And they were saying, yeah, we're doing a ritual. Got to summon some demons or some fiends. And, we were promised lots of souls. And Chromia apparently recognized them as Yugolas and called them out. And was like, oh, you're Yugolas. Bilbrod had never heard of Yugolas except, in passing. They're not something that he can summon, so he doesn't really know too much about them, as opposed to, like, demons and devils and elementals and stuff. And at some point, I forget exactly why, but, dialogue broke down and hostilities ensued. And this is the battle that I was talking about. Oh my goodness, these guys were strong. They could summon other Yugolas, and they could fly, and they were immune to charm, and they were resistant to like all kinds of damage, and they could cast spells, like so many spells, so powerful. Cloud kills, and hold person, and chain lightning, and fireball, and counterspell, and banishment. So right away, Chromia got banished and was out for like 3 or 4 rounds. And the rest of us were spellcasters. And because there were multiple Yugolas, there was a lot of Yugoloth cast chain lightning. One of us counterspells. And then one of the other Yugolas would counterspell the counterspell. And so they were like throwing out all kinds of counterspells, and we were unable to stop them from blasting us with all kind of damage. And so even though Bilbrod had started the battle in a really good position, he did get hit by a couple of these chain lightnings and ate like 50 damage or 60 damage or something, which is problematic. and then they started advancing on the party, and they were right in my face, and I felt compelled for the very first time to activate my Stone Shape Ultimate Defense. And I have 3 different versions, and so I'll put a picture of the version that I was using, but this is a powerful version that completely cuts me off from line of effect. So I wasn't able to be affected by their fireballs and their chain lightnings and all of that. And then I would have been able to open the hatch with my interact with object and make my attacks. And then Fargar could make his attacks and then use his interact with object to close the hatch. And then I was basically completely safe when it wasn't my turn. And it almost got counterspelled. And when he said, I counterspell that, I practically felt like I was going to have a heart attack, because I would have been in a very bad position. And thankfully, Jazzkern counterspelled their counterspell, and I was able to get my Stone Shape off. And because of that, I was able to continually press my offensive and get my Tentacle Rod attacks out and my Obsidian Spears out without having to worry about getting taken down. Because in the meantime, people were getting paralyzed and losing concentration, and like there was an elemental that was summoned and that got disappeared, and then we polymorphed someone to a giant ape and then that got disrupted, and Jazzkern got brought down to 0, and Chromia was gone for a long time due to the banishment. It was like 3 or 4 rounds until Fargar was able to land a tentacle rod attack that disrupted the concentration, and Chromia was back. And then once Chromia was back, he was able to dash over with expeditious retreat and get good position on the Yugoloth, and he was starting to do damage to it, and Bilbrod was continuing to do damage to it with the obsidian spears, and we finally won that battle. But man, I really enjoyed that battle. That was a lot of fun from my perspective. It was really cool to see that sort of high-level spellcasting duel with all of these different counterspells and stuff going on, and just all of these crazy effective spells that they were throwing out. And they were really tough. Like, they were flying, and I had summoned a shadow spawn, so it wasn't really all that effective. It did get a few hits in before they took to the air, but once they took to the air, it was like, I wish I'd gone with the Beholderkin. But yeah, we managed to win that battle. Very exciting. And we had just enough time to squeeze in another long rest before the ritual was going to be completed. So we found another door that took us down to another chamber. And there we found the boss of the cultists, who was accompanied by this really giant dude in plate mail. He was huge. And there were two weird masked, robed, tattooed dudes that, you know, going in, I presume that they were spellcasters. And Bill Braun got a chance to conjure an elemental for the first time. I just added that. I should mention, this is my first adventure as a ninth level character. I will be doing a tactical analysis of my current level, because I've changed a lot of stuff since seventh level, which was the last one that I did. But conjure elemental is one of the things that I added through Minions of Chaos, the invocation. And so it was cool to get an air elemental out there for the first time. Elementals are very powerful. Even though it does have that fairly significant drawback of you not being able to lose concentration on them. And it was a very interesting battle. The leader, like, wild-shaped or polymorphed or something into, like, a magma snake. I don't really know what it was. And then was summoning shadows and stuff. And these tattoos conferred upon them pretty crazy powers. Like, they could hit you with really powerful necrotic bolts. And then those necrotic bolts would, like, actually put tattoos on you, and then you couldn't heal. And the tattoos were regenerating them. It was constantly giving them, like, temporary hit points and healing damage. And my air elemental literally killed one of the dudes on the first round, because I got a critical on one of its attacks. And then it resuscitated through the tattoos, and it resuscitated twice. We had to kill that bastard three times for it to stick. And it was pretty hilarious, because at one point the giant guy went and closed the door. There was like a door between us and the room, and so we started by opening the door, and Chromia and my elemental ran in, but the rest of us were all like casters, right? So we were all kind of like chilling in the back, and so this giant guy shut the door. And then we couldn't do anything. And the door was like, the whole thing was wood. So Bill Braun was planning on using stone shape to just like create arrow slits so that we could all blast them with our ranged powers and spells without them being able to attack us. But it was all wood. And so Bill Braun did use a stone shape to create a tunnel underneath. But before we could do that, we were able to actually get the door open, because Witch summoned a giant constrictor snake, and it was strong enough to push the door open, because the dude that had closed it, we killed him, but his huge body was just sitting there blocking the door. But luckily the giant constrictor snake was strong enough to push it open despite the body blocking it, and then we were able to get into the room and more or less take control of the battle. That battle wasn't as difficult as the previous battle against the Ugloss, which, like I said, was probably my most difficult and funnest battle that I've had so far. And in this room, we found Annabelle, who was, you know, on the precipice of being sacrificed to this ritual, but we stopped it in time, and we saved Annabelle, and we took her back to her father, who was very happy with us, and paid us very handsomely with a lot of gold and adamantine half plate, and a bloodstone spell gem. I don't know if you guys are aware, but spell gems are some of the most powerful items in the game, because any spell that you put into them can be cast out of them with an action. So you can weaponize things like Tiny Hut and Forbiddance and Hallow and like really crazy spells that take a long time. A Private Sanctum, Phantom Steed. I mean, use your imagination. Tiny Hut is probably the strongest weaponized application, but yeah, being able to convert these things into action cast, that's amazing. I didn't get that, but still, it was a hell of a reward to get for this adventure. That was pretty much it. We headed back to the TFC HQ to get our badges for a mission success, and I had a hell of a great time. So I want to thank DM Lansland for providing me that experience. I want to thank the team for helping me get through it, in particular Jazz Kern, who totally saved my ass with that counterspell when I was trying to get my stone shape down. And thank you so much for watching. This has been Bill Bronson Dragons. I'm your host, Bill Bron Bafflestone. See you next time.